Hello dear friends, this is Dr. Deepesh Patel and I'll be teaching you jet propulsion and aircraft engineering. This is lecture 5 and I'm going to cover in this lecture certain subtopics such as design of combustion chamber and heat transfer and cooling aspects. So let's start with the design of combustion chamber. Now, since we have discussed, the combustion chamber has to resist a very high temperature and high pressure, and therefore the combustion chamber should consist of a cylindrical shape with a fuel injectors and a converging diverging nozzles. The chamber volume is defined as the volume up to the nozzle throat section. Now, the volume and shape are selected after evaluating certain parameters for the combustion chamber, and these parameters are: the first one is the volume has to be big enough or large enough for a proper mixing of fuel and oxidizers, evaporations of propellant, and complete combustions of the propellant. The chamber diameter and volume can have an impact on the cooling requirement. If the chamber volume and diameter are large, the heat transfer rates to the wall will be reduced. On the other hand, if volume and cross section is small, chamber gas velocities and heat transfer rate will be increased. Third parameter, like all the inner component, should have a minimum mass, so we can have a low weight as well as the size of the combustion chamber is greatly reduced. Then the manufacturing considerations favor a simple chamber geometry, so the combustion chamber geometry should be simple. The length of chamber relate directly to the overall length of the vehicle. A large diameter but short chamber length can allow a shorter vehicle. The gas pressure drop for accelerating the combustion products within the chamber should be minimum. For the same thrust, the combustion volume and the nozzle throat area become smaller as the operating chamber pressure is increased. Now, let's move forward to the characteristics length. The characteristics combustion chamber length is defined as the length that a chamber of the same volume would have if it were a straight tube and had no converging nozzle section. Now, here we have relations to calculate the characteristics length, where L is equal to V suffix C divided by A suffix D, where L is a characteristics chamber length, V suffix C is a chamber volume, and A suffix D is a nozzle throat area. Typical value of the characteristics chamber length are between 0.8 and 3.0 meters for several biopropellants, while it is higher for the monopropellants. Next, let's move forward to the chamber wall stresses. Now, since the combustion chamber has to withstand against the high pressure and high temperature, the chamber or the combustion chamber wall has to undergo various stresses, and those stresses are: the walls of chamber are subject to radial and axial loads from the chamber pressure, flight accelerations, vibrations, and even the thermal stresses. They also have to withstand ignition pressure shock, often due to excessive propellant accumulation in the chamber. Sometimes the propellant get accumulated inside the combustion chamber, and because of that, these propellant ignite with the higher shock, high pressure shock. In addition, the chamber walls have to transmit thrust load as well as forces to the wall. Also have to survive a thermal shock. A heat transfer analysis is usually done only for the most critical walls regions, such as near the nozzle, throat and exit, and at a critical location in the chamber. The thermal stress induced by the temperature difference across the walls are often the most severe stresses. The temperature differential introduces a compressive stresses on the inside and a tensile stresses on the outside of the inner walls. And these stresses can be calculated by the certain relations. Temperature stresses frequently exceed the yield point, and the material experiences a change in the yield strength and modulus of elasticity with temperature. The most severe thermal stresses can occur during the start, when the hot gases causes a thermal shock, and these transient thermal gradients cause severe thermal strains and local yielding. So during the initial startup, the hot gases that are generated inside the combustion chamber, which creates the thermal shock on the walls and certain components of the combustion chambers. And the these component has to withstand against these thermal shocks. Now let's move forward to the next topic, which is the heat transfer and cooling aspects. Now the heat is transmitted to all internal hardware surfaces exposed to hot gases, namely the injector face, the chamber and nozzle walls. The heat transfer per unit wall area varies within the engine. So like the heat transfer is not constant across the whole combustion chamber. The amount of heat transfer by conduction from the chamber gas to the wall in a motor thrust chamber is negligible. By far largest part of the heat is transferred by the convection. So the overall heat transfer takes place by convection is larger than the conduction. Higher chamber pressure leads to higher vehicle performance, but also to withstand engine inert mass. However, the resulting increase of heat transfer with chamber pressure often imposed design of material limits on the maximum practical chamber pressure for engine. Next one is the various methods to for the cooling of the combustion chamber. Now, since we use the several method for cooling the walls so that the temperature is maintained at a safe level inside the combustion chamber, and these methods are: the first one is regenerative cooling, in which outer surface is cooled by coolant. And most of the time, the liquid hydrogen is used as a coolant. Second one is a transpiration cooling. In transpiration cooling, a porous inner wall is cooled by force flow of coolant fluid through the porous materials. And same liquid hydrogen can also be used here as a coolant. Third one is a film cooling, where a thin layer of cooling fluid is maintained over the inner surface of the wall. And as we have seen the cooling the film in many other components, this is also been an effective cooling system inside the liquid propellant or solid propellant rocket engines. And the last one is a coatings. In coatings, a layer of low conductivity material is deposited as a thermal barrier on the inner gas side of the walls where the coating takes place and which would prevent the heat transfer. So these are the various methods which is used for the cooling in the rocket engine. Now this is all at the moment. If you have any doubt, you can write down in the comment box. Thank you very much.